making music every night. Discover what is all around. It's the big sound in a small town. It's the big sound in a small town.
Hi, and welcome to Big Sound Small Town. I'm your host, Sandy Carlton, and this is a podcast about the lives and stories of the musicians, writers, artists, and their associates that have their roots in the small towns and communities across America. If you like what you hear, tell somebody. Enjoy. Decided to do an upstate South Carolina edition, Neil Majunkin was one of the first people who came to mind. Back in the 80s, early 80s, I saw Neil performing with his band Slewfoot in the Bowery in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. And I thought to myself at that time, that was one of the most talented musicians I know of. Well, not only was he talented and go on to have a long career, he's a nice guy too. And he brought something to the show that no one ever has. Neil wrote a song the night before, especially for the podcast. He came in, he did a wonderful job on it, and then he left me the original lyrics, handwritten lyrics to the song. Now, for me, as a songwriter, as a person whose life is surrounded by music, getting the original lyrics to the song is as cool a thing that can happen for me. So, Neil, thank you so much.
Sure. Let's talk about it. You ready now?
Yeah.
Morning's here, good's replaced the bad with the best tango that I never had. No, I ain't drink a drop, if you please. There's lightning in a bottle, there's lightning in the sky. I spent too many years with my life flashing by. I've forgotten how the cold rays sting. I'm almost sober now. My mother, she would be so proud. Her little boy's rolled back the ears. His bloodshot eyes are turning clear. And I'm almost sober now. 40 plus 3 minus 15 beers equals the greatest sum of my drunken years, not counting all the tears from my lover's eyes. I was never known to stick around. Went off searching in another town for a pot of gold I still haven't found. I'm almost sober now. My mother, she would be so proud. Her little boy's rolled back the years. His bloodshot eyes are turning clear. And I'm almost sober now. Maybe someone will take what's left of me, but I'm not holding my breath, you see. I've had chances, there's no one else flame. I've made my choices and they were my own. Let's save that thought for another song. Time to toss that bottle and bury her name. And I'm almost sober now. My mother, she would be so proud. Her little boy has rolled back the years. His bloodshot eyes are turning clear. And I'm almost sober now. Yeah, life can be mean, it can be cruel. I've wasted mine acting a fool, but I'm determined to get it right somehow. The sky's dark and it's dark to rain, but there's no poison in my veins. I'm getting over you, I'm almost sober now. And I'm almost sober now. My mother, she would be so proud. Her little boy has rolled back the years. His bloodshot eyes are turning clear. And I'm almost sober now. Yeah, I'm almost sober now.
Hello, this is Neil McJunkin. I'm from Liberty, South Carolina, but a longtime musician. Been playing for over 50 years out in the bars and a few big stages and on some records, and now record my own music as well as keep on playing everybody else's. And I hope you enjoy this podcast we're going to do today with Sandy, and we'll be going over some music I've done and a little history of my past, and looking forward to it.
All right. Well, welcome to the show, Neil. I'm glad to have you here. You know, you're a legendary South Carolina musician. I mean, you ask around, and one of the first people that comes to mind is you. How did that happen? I mean, did you wake up one day and decide, I'm going to be a famous musician?
I'm kind of humbled by that statement, Sandy, but thank you so much. I've been doing it a long time for sure. We had a lot of good musicians around our area from Liberty. It's, you know, not many of them that well known, but they were some great players. And I think my brother Steve and I took an interest in guitar about the same time. And of course, we'd been listening to the Ventures, and Daddy always had the great country music on,
right,
on Saturdays and stuff. So we listened to that in the background, but we kind of was pop oriented. We started playing the Beatles and the Stones, and we both got a guitar about the same time. And I'd say, sitting in the bedroom, my older brother was kind of my first major influence. He played and sang, so he encouraged me a lot. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, you had encouragement from your family, right?
Yeah. Dad was he believed in chasing your dream. He was a pro baseball player, so he chased his dream for a while.
Yeah. Parental support's pretty big on when you choose whether you're going to be a musician or not.
Yeah, it really is. I don't think Daddy understood everything we did, but he certainly supported us. Yes, sir.
So did at some point, I guess you, after you thought you were good enough to form a band?
Well,
or you did you play by yourself first?
No, you're familiar with Odell Scott played with Slewfoot. You know, I think he and my brother Steve and I played our first job together, and we played it. Odell's mom and dad's one of their restaurants. I think they had two or three at a time, and we played one of them at night. We played our pay was a plate of spaghetti.
That's
my first paying.
How old would you have been about that time?
Probably about 14.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
13, 14, I guess.
That's great. Now, to start out now, You're a fabulous vocalist. Did you realize that early on, or were you more interested in being like a guitar player?
Well, I just love music. I didn't really start singing. I think Steve, our first little band we had in the bedroom was me and Odell and Steve, I think, called the Fontanas, I believe it was. And they were doing more of the singing. And then there was a real good singer from Liberty, I mean, exceptionally good, named Ace Bowie. And I played in the band with his brother. He played keyboards with me and stuff. We'd knock around, and my brother and some other guys were singing. And all of a sudden, you know, everybody's graduated. Some of them's off in the war.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And there's nobody left around. So Ace says, well, you're going to have to start singing now. And I said, you know, like, I don't know about this so much. But so I started giving some stabs at it and do a little more. By the time I'd left high school, well, I played nightclubs in Greenville.
Right.
Why you know, I think in my junior high years. And then I went to a place called, kind of a famous teenage club back in the day, called it Chicken Shack.
Yeah.
And people come from about three states. And honestly, there'd be many hundreds, maybe 400 or 500 kids there on Friday night or something. So they had, you know, by that time I graduated, and me and my brother Steve and his wife, Susan. And you know, we had all the guys playing instruments were so good that they let me play a little bit, you know, on guitar, but I was singing more.
Well, do you remember kind of the stuff you were doing at that time? What kind of music?
We were doing everything from Dionne Warwick to Vanilla Fudge.
That's good, though. I mean, you know, that's how you develop as a yeah. musician, you know?
I remember playing Keep Me Hanging On, Vanilla Fudge style.
Oh, yeah.
And we were trying to do our own pyrotechnics at that time, and they set my pants on fire. I remember that. And they were caught, little cotton pants. They burn up about 6 or 8 inches before I could get them put out.
That's funny. So at this point, have you decided that you're going to do this for a living? Or
yeah.
Did you even give it any thought?
You know, everybody has dreams. I came from a little bitty high school and played football. I played rec league. I only played my last 2 years, my junior and senior year, so Daddy played some ball, so I was thinking, you know, maybe I'd go to college. But I don't think I had those kind of skills or size at all, so a football coach would ask me, so why don't you, you know, get more serious about that? I said, well, and why do you play? Because I get through playing the ball game, have to hurry to the next town over to play in the band after the games and stuff like we did on Friday nights. And I knew I had a lot better shot playing music than I did being a sports. Anyway, I started thinking about that, and we had, I guess I brought up Odell's name several times, but he and I played together a lot, so he's part of it. We played in Greenville. We started playing in nightclubs with some other guys, and most of the guys, I think, were a little bit better than us, but we had some raw skill, you know. And that time, my voice was high enough, probably to sing girl songs if I had to, you know, in the same key. So I get hired for my vocals a lot. Like I said, they just kind of let me strum rhythm
and
keep from hurting my feelings or something, you know. Because, but we gradually, you know, got better, and we ran into some guys. They had a club called the Black Steer there around that area outside of Greenville toward Greer, and a lot of stars would come through. They had, you know, Gary Puckett and Percy Sledge and whoever. We actually hooked up with Bill Haley's band after a show, and if you know, Bill was kind of on his way down, you know, he wasn't
right.
You know, he was popular than the Beatles at one time over
in
England.
Big time,
you know,
in the
amazing
future.
You know, at one time. So we was go back, hang around the motel and stuff with them, and they would actually do it like the Beatles did, hiding from Brian Epstein. They'd hide from Bill Haley, you know, because he won't have pep talks in them, you know, after the show in the middle of the night. So we started hanging around some, you know, meeting some players and stuff, and it gave us, you know, some ideas and some aspirations.
And so what's the next step you take?
The first I played with my brother and some real good guys and his wife, you know, with another band, and Benny Dellinger's next band. He later on became a member of Nantucket, you know.
Okay,
so he was,
yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. Again, I always played with these great guitar players, and so he, hey, let me play rhythm. Let me play rhythm again, but I wasn't singing. So we were real popular, and we did a few things. We actually, Mother's Finest, they actually opened for us.
Oh, really?
Well, that's let me tell you, I'm going to say it to brag, because we looked at each other after they did their set, and we went,
oh my,
yeah. So we realized we was in trouble. So we had three nights booked with them. So we got together with them and talked to them, let's flip this thing around here. So we have, you know, because it was ugly after they played for us.
Mother Finest, man.
Yeah, they were amazing. They were so amazing. Good, just they were so down to earth. And
that's great.
I think the drummer that played with him at first, I think he's playing with Marshall Tucker now, maybe.
Oh, see.
Maybe he already was.
Yeah.
And
Benny good.
went on the road together in some other bands, and another guy played with Nantucket was with us, you know, another David Johnson, one, me, right. Our friend, but his name, they call him Thumbs. He was a bass player, great singer. Vocals about like that guy with Foreigner. He was just great, but he wanted to be the bass player. And but I branched. I think the first full. Now I played all the way from, you know, in nightclubs all the way from, like I said, from '60s. You know, that point, and he would open for some big name bands and stuff. But when I went out on the road, actually traveling full time, was a group from Spartanburg.
Oh, okay.
Called Wooden Apple.
Okay.
You may remember them. Mm-hmm. And it was. I just knew then I wasn't looking back. It's just like, and again, I still playing rhythm guitar. They still had Bailey Johnson was on lead guitar in that band, and he was real nice to me. He's great. He encouraged me, but he would have let me play, but he was a better guitar player. So I was still playing rhythm and singing, and then went on. I end up after left that band, I ended up with the Royal Family. I believe it was used to be Billy Joe Royal's backup band. Andre and all that occurred. And I ended up with them, and they worked with Billy Joe, wasn't playing at that time. So we did some jobs, all over the place, throughout the Southeast and stuff. And then we played with the Coasters for a few jobs. I remember them with no saxophone.
Oh, really?
And thank goodness we did have enough. But still, I was on rhythm guitar. We had a boy from Union, South Carolina, playing, Tim Robinson, playing lead guitar at that point. So we were went with them, and then I went out with by myself. You asked me earlier.
Yeah.
I've done it two or three times in my life. I don't mind. I think you saw me do it at the Bowery. I grab a guitar and play by myself my way, but. Never like to hear myself for a whole night. I just never enjoyed hearing myself.
That's also a hard gig by yourself.
It is, and it's boring, and I guess it can be rewarding if you really, in it just for the money or self-centered or something. But I never took myself that serious. But then I stayed at that a little while. Then I got with we formed a four-piece band called Driving Wheel, and. I went out with three guys that had never been on the road.
Oh.
And they were younger. They were just coming out of their teens. And I was in my 20s, but I was the old man of the group. I was kind of like band leader and father figure and whatever else. And we had a good little sound, but Robbie Turner, well, Slewfoot, they changed their name on their second year at the Bowery. They had taken the job at Myrtle Beach after Alabama left. And Robbie, he was going by Robbie Turner then. He later on, really successful songwriter. He's in South Carolina Hall of Fame, Music Hall of Fame now, inducted last year. And he had, Watermelon Crawl, I'm Over You, all them songs. He great songwriter, singer, But he decided, it was time to move to Nashville. And he was certainly qualified, and he done well for himself. So he decided to leave the band, and they asked me to come in and I think we talked about, I was somewhere, came in from, you saw me when,
yeah,
I came
I
in.
I
That's
did.
Weird because you saw me about the time I came in. I don't remember where I think the last place I played was Florida before I came back to Sleepwood or somewhere, but I was obligated and I wanted to fill my obligation. And you know, I loved the Bowery, and especially the early years, it was different. It was different. You know Bugs, it was the manager.
Oh, yeah.
And Bugs is my friend. Oh, he'd get on to you, you know, when, you know, if he thought I was a little over the top or something.
Sure.
I think I was the first one to start wearing. Well, I think I was the first guy that started wearing shorts in the Bowery. They had a rule
again.
Oh, yeah,
man.
You remember?
I've got those pictures of you guys in those shorts.
Oh, Lord. Oh. Well, we started off with blue jean shorts. We moved to the beachwear shop. And I'm not going to live that down, you know.
No, you're not.
Never. I mean, you know.
I've seen the pictures with the high socks.
Oh, high
the
socks.
Short shorts.
Short nylon socks. Yeah. Shorts. And,
yeah, oh, yeah.
And I don't think we ever lived that down. But it was so hot in there. You know,
oh,
they wasn't running no air.
Victor
right. later on put air. They wasn't running no air. And it was just so hot. And so, and people were actually standing in line wrapped around to the other side and across the road,
yeah,
and trying to get a place in the Bowery, you know, at that point, you know, everybody wants
to explain to people who don't know how the Bowery works. I mean, you know, it's world famous without a doubt. A lot of people have gone there on their vacations, you know, but just give them an idea of how a typical day at the Bowery would go for you.
Well, at that time, you know, it was just really one of the only two things to do in that area, the beach wagon they had down there, and they had a great country band there. You know, they were more rehearsed and playing
right.
what was on the charts. They had their set rehearsed, and they were great. But Bowery, we was like a human jukebox.
Yeah, y'all were.
That's what we had to be. You know, just, I mean, you had a tip bucket in front of you.
Right.
Before this COVID thing came along playing for tips, you had a tip bucket in front
yeah.
of you, and that's what you did every night. And you had to be pretty sharp or you're going to starve to death. So what, people would just sit there and drink draft beer. There was no dancing at that
right.
point. There was no dancing. And they would just listen, which is actually kind of a good thing for a
yeah,
musician.
It's a really good
you know,
thing.
You're the center just before karaoke and all this. And you
yeah.
know you're not needing attention, but you know someone's actually
listening to you.
Listening.
Yeah, it's
you know,
like a listening room almost.
Right. The TV screens aren't going behind
sure.
the band, and you know they're not
right.
asking you to slide over 2 feet so they can finish watching the ball game while you're playing, you know.
Yeah.
So the respect issue was there, and we took the job serious too. We played hard, and it's a hard gig, like six, and then like in July, sometimes like 6.5 days a week, you do a matinee show, and,
right.
and it doesn't sound like much, but when you do it for months at a time.
And what kind of time would you come to work there?
I think we started, I believe it was 7 or 7:15 we start, and then they would make us quit. The police were real strict about it back then. They kept it real tidy down there, I'll say, on the strand there. And we had to quit by 1:30.
Okay.
You know, they'd make us quit. And according, if you're in Bug's favor or not, it's during the, naturally, you didn't quit during July and June, so
oh,
I kept.
Yeah.
But on the off months, if you were in good favor with Bugs, he might let you stop at 1:15 or 1:10 something. But if he was mad at you, you might go to 1:40, you know, and the police be looking at through the door. But the Bowery, I have a lot of respect for Victor that owns and operates the Bowery now, Victor Sharma, good friend. And it's, to me, I played a lot of places, and I think it's the world's best little honky-tonk. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
it's not like, you know, when a honky-tonk, it's not like a Texas
no, it's
bar
not.
Room or something, but it's a listening room with beer and stuff, and there's ghosts in the air there, and you know, it's just, these vibes are in there, that room, you can feel it. When you took that stage,
oh yeah.
Well, Robbie, I talked about him a while ago, Zach Turner, I talked, you know, he had left. But he played keyboards. He sat down and he sat to the side. So when they came in after Alabama, they didn't actually have a front man.
Okay.
And Janet hadn't started, you know, she
right.
came on, did a lot of vocals for us and did on the records and stuff. That was Phil's wife. She hadn't, she was there with Phil, but she hadn't started singing with the band yet. So there hadn't been a front man behind Randy.
Right.
Yeah, I mean,
you step in on center stage and you can't even hide Randy Owen. Yeah, I mean, yeah, you know, he was good looking. He could sing. Yeah. He knew 3,000 songs. Yeah. I mean, you know, I guess the only thing me and him had in common was he played rhythm guitar. I still play rhythm.
That's a good one. Yeah, I love it. But you do have to know. I mean, I guess your catalog was pretty vast.
Well, yeah, I can remember one of the first requests I came, the lady comes up, and she's from West Virginia, and she wants to hear Tom Dooley. Usually it was Country Roads from West Virginia, but Tom Dooley
and Wagon Wheel of the Day.
Yeah, we don't know. Yeah, that's exactly Wagon Wheel of the Day. So we don't know. I said, yes, we do, too. My grandpa made me learn them songs, and I said, and I think I sang, maybe I might have known 2 verses at that time, but we sang, she did it about 3 times that night, give us $20.
Well, yeah.
That's a lot of money back then.
Oh, God, Lord, you know? Yeah.
We knew we was going to eat tomorrow. We're going to Chinese buffet tomorrow.
Oh, yeah. So, well, now, tell them about the living situation, too, during that time. I mean, that was part of the deal, was it not?
No, they didn't put us up. Odell and them was there for a while. They had a house over Miss Eva Page house on 7th Avenue North, right across from Chapin's. You know, Chapin's one of those things kind of like I had everything, a grocery store, a clothing store,
right?
Hardware, everything in one store. But it was like a two-story, and it had like garage apartments up downstairs and up in the garage out back, outdoor shower. I still love them today. We did have a clawfoot tub, but it had an outdoor shower. They'd have to cut it off. We didn't stay year round back then, but I ended up staying there year round later on. But you said you remember Plum Bob, he lived back there with his girlfriend at the time in the back room, and I moved in. Actually, my bedroom, I can't make it. It was supposed to be like a living room area, and we set it up, and then and Odell had the other room, and we lived there. And then Phil and Janet, they stayed in a mobile home somewhere down there, you know. But it was kind of like a big band house, and everybody, it was a popular place right beside the liquor store.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, good place, yeah.
So everybody was coming in and out all day long, slamming. We didn't lock our doors.
Did y'all jam during that time, or were y'all just too wore out from playing?
Mostly, we'd listen to music. Some before we worked in Sunday afternoon, you had a stereo be going.
Oh, yeah.
It'd be going all day. You know, we didn't jam much playing, but we had the stereo going. You know, and
I guess you'd figure out if you came across a song you wanted to do. I guess you'd just figure.
Yeah, and every now and then, you know, I had come from the pop band, a lot of pop bands, you know, before I got into country. I had played country on a little house gig one time before that, but mostly just Merle Haggard. I like Merle Haggard a lot. You know, that's my man. I can't sing like Merle Haggard, but
nothing,
I like him. I just do everything my way. I've seen here a lot of people try to imitate him. I let them go ahead and do it. I know I can't get there, so I just do it my way. But
yeah.
They had, they'd bring me some records every now and it's like, hey,
learn this.
What about this one? Needs new material here? And we put in something. And then we brought Janet on. Oh.
I guess that created a whole different type of color.
Yeah. They got a little words or piano for it. I didn't know her. Oh.
Did you know anybody in there before you went?
Yeah. Phil, you know, Odell and I had played together. And then later on, by 82, I'd brought Mark in out of driving wheel, like the band did. I mean, I'd, you know, recommend him.
Right.
And Phil and I knew each other. Phil played with a real good, kind of a rock pop band, you know, kind of doing the same circuit I was, except they were more rock oriented. When I told y'all, when I went out Wooden Apple, they were dressed up in these fancy uniforms and stuff. And they played out west some and stuff. I remember he called me, Texas offered me a job in the band one time, but I'm going to think maybe I was with Apple in, and I just wanted to stay put, you know, where it was. And so they had faith in me that I could walk in and do that job unrehearsed. And that's a big step, a big risk, because you just took Alabama's place, you know.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
a big risk. And for me, I have to say, I, you know, I've always just been me, so I wasn't nervous. I just did what I did, you know, and the songs I could sing and sing my way. But
it
worked, though. Yeah, I mean, we did their songs. I mean, they came, they dropped by, and they parked their bus over across from the 7th Avenue over in Chapin's parking lot when they was in town. But we did, you know, Mountain Music, Tennessee River, you know, those were requests. Everybody was really high on them.
Yeah, I guess you did have to do a lot of that.
We did, and we didn't mind. We didn't get offended, but we actually took it, the ones that talked to us most, they would tell us, yeah, y'all do, you know, pretty good job on that. You know, Teddy, Randy, whoever they were, they were always really nice to us. Good. I mean,
those are big shoes to follow.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's just those guys knew so many songs, and they really did. They earned it. I mean, a lot of people think they didn't stumble upon that. I mean, they practiced their harmonies, and I mean, they deserve everything they ever got. They're great, you know.
Yeah. So how long did you stay there?
I stayed with Slewfoot. We left. We did 81 when I was with them, 81 through 83, and then Maurice Petty, Richard's brother, became our manager. And we did a lot of stuff working at the racetrack, stuff like that, through R.J. Reynolds and the big back then.
Those jobs changed
a little bit, but we did Talladega. You know, you look out there, when you're out there playing, you're out there, I don't know, were they 50, 60,000, whatever, you're out there playing, you know,
that many
people, and you meet a lot of people from, we played Talladega, the night before we party, and then the next day Alabama was the grand marshal of the race, and again we're all down there, and we play before that many people, and you just do what you do. Sound equipment's a lot better nowadays, so I don't know how we sounded.
But
it was nice working with them, and we you know, Richard was driving for Curb Records for a while. That was his sponsor.
Yeah,
you remember
that?
So we kind of had a little thing going there where it's kind of connected, and it almost got there, but didn't quite make it. You know, it's one of the things that went to the negotiation table,
I don't know what happened.
I wasn't involved in negotiations. It didn't quite pan out in the end. So.
Well, did I see a picture of you singing the national anthem maybe at a Braves game?
Yes, I want to say that probably was 1983.
Okay.
And we did the national anthem, and it was on, you know, live broadcast. They were playing the Dodgers that day, and somebody gave me some pictures of the day, you know, the old Kodaks, they little scrounge you, but there's one picture with Phil Negro leaning over, had a little barrier for us. He's leaning over like something, he's sitting there watching us play, and you know, and then
that's pretty cool.
The Mad Hungarian's got his arms around Janet.
Huh?
He's actually, she said he bit her on there. He's actually, see the picture, he's actually never on here. I'm not sure what she thought about that, but he did it. And he wore it when he pitched that day. It's against the rules, the baseball league rules, but he had a Slewfoot. He wore a Slewfoot
shirt on it.
And if you find the whole rock, he actually opened up his shirt and showed her. But all the guys that drove, not all the guys, but a lot of the guys that drove from NASCAR are running Slewfoot stickers on their car.
Oh, that's great.
I don't know what that would have cost you. Most of them would put them there at the gas tank.
That cost you a bunch.
Yeah, when they'd pit, you know, you see Slewfoot stickers, and I mean, all the great drivers, they were good to us and pulling on us. And the people from R.J. Reynolds, we wasn't actually under direct sponsorship like Alabama was with the Salem Light Tour and all that, but we did have a lot of help from them.
That's great too, man. I mean, that's just
we had help from them.
That's pretty big time stuff.
Yeah, it was big, but that's probably the first really good glimpse I got of corporate money. You know, I mean, like I said, they wouldn't hand us, but they paid us well. If we played on Sunday, if we were going to do Talladega on Sunday, they wanted us in Talladega by Wednesday.
Yeah.
And they were paying for the eats. They were paying for the motel. And we could eat. There wasn't none of us skinny, you know, so we could
eat. That's good.
Except for Janet. I guess she always was fit, but the rest of us, but they had, but yeah, it was, but you start learning too, and you start seeing, and we had some brushes with Nashville before that, you know, and we'd already been there for our chart records. I think they were in 86. We had the live album that was recorded in 82.
Okay.
And but we didn't get them back to 83. They didn't mix it and get them to us to 83.
Oh, yeah, well.
We didn't get them that season. And we had brushes. We went up there and recorded some stuff. I don't think anybody has any copies of it. You know, the early stuff. I don't even think anybody. I could told you I did a Ronnie McDowell song with him in the studio. I never understand why I did it, but I did it. And we did some other good stuff and working around a lot of good producers and players, extra players on stuff. And we played there. We started playing some, you know, clubs in Nashville and stuff, some, you know, the bigger ones and stuff like that, not on Broadway and thing. But it was nice, and we were learning. You have to learn about a bit. It's business is different, you know, than you thought it was when you were growing up. You just could change the world, with your guitar and your singing. So.
Right. Well, now, what did y'all do in the summers off? What did you do then? Go out and play other places?
Well, in the wintertime, they was real good to us around home. We did tour other places. We met people at the Bowery that, like, took us to Ohio, places like that, and they would use us in their club. North Carolina, we played, we played one club up in Winston-Salem. Well, we played two clubs there. I don't recall the names, I'll be honest, but we played, and they'd come see us, and then we played different places. But folks around Greenville and Greenwood, South Carolina, Sleaford could pack a club. About every time, we pulled in, the place was packed. It was going to be a party, and everybody going to have a good time, and our friends were really good to us.
That's good. I mean, that's really good.
Yeah.
What happens after Slewfoot?
After I left Slewfoot in 87, and I want to think, I don't remember, maybe 80, I don't know if it was 88 or 89, I came back. I went back to the Bowery they had a band called Showdown. Real good country singer, Steve Cox. He's Anderson, South Carolina. He's tremendous. And they brought me back on. Steve's a good guitar player. So by that time, I was playing, starting to play some lead too. So me and him was playing the leads, and he was singing the majority of songs. And so I stayed there with them. I think I left in 1990.
Wow,
and I moved up toward North Myrtle Beach. With my playing, that is. I still over, I had moved on 15th Avenue. I had left 7th Avenue by that time. But anyway, they had, we played Ocean Annie's. I don't know if you heard that beach bar there. It's kind of a famous beach bar up there. You go down Shore Drive past 2001 and all that stuff, and you end up on the, you're playing right on the ocean every day. You got paid. You didn't have to play for tips.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You actually got paid, yeah.
And got paid pretty good, so it was hot.
Yeah,
and
sure.
The weather, you'd have to change strings about every day or every other day because the weather would ruin your stuff, but it was a hot job. But it was, you met a lot of people, and I was working with a guy that had a job with Robert Barrington. I think he's originally from North Carolina. He, bass player with a big, thick voice, just sang really good. And so he and I were doing the vocals in that band and playing a little bit. You might be playing Billy Ocean and then Jimmy Buffett and Margaritaville, whatever, a little bit different than what I've been playing, but it's making a living, making money, raise a family. So that would be 90. After that, I believe we formed Kid Coat then. As I tell you, we ended up pretty good jobs, traveling around, playing different places, and we played in Japan twice. I think Carolina Opry sent us over there the first time, but they had some involvement with with that. I don't remember Calvin Gilmore how we were chosen to play, and it was Now that was different.
I was playing in Japan. Yes.
They treat us like kings. I mean, they treat us so good, and everybody was just. I still have gifts that they gave me. I had to leave stuff. We couldn't carry stuff home.
Really?
No, I couldn't get it all on plane. You know, I'd had to pay so many taxes and tariffs, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was different.
Did you have a translator go with you guys, or did you just figure
they
it out?
They met us there with a guy. It was, I remember he was a karate instructor there. But he's kind of one of the larger Japanese guys, taller guy. He had been to the University of Minnesota. And so he was... He could talk slang and everything, you know. So he gets in there and he gives us kind of enough to cut to the chase, you know. Right. You know, their Japanese slang and stuff. And I stayed there. We went just twice. I learned how to say left, right, straight. What is this? What is this?
Yeah, that's great.
So, but.
So how long did you stay when you would go?
We stayed like 6 or 6.5 weeks or something, I think.
Wow.
First time in about the same amount. So, and first time we weren't working but 3 30-minute shows. And I think the second time we were working like 2 20-minute sets.
Really?
Yeah, and we're doing a medley. We might do a one change it up. We might do a Hank Williams Sr. medley one night, or and then, you know, then we might play whatever's on the charts in America at times. She don't know she's beautiful or whatever was on the charts, you know, and yard sale, whatever was on the charts at the time. And we actually recorded a live CD there.
Oh, really?
At that club, yeah, live from the Bourbon House over there. And so it was, they had, I think that whole tape was done on ADAT when ADAT first came out, and then mixed down and put the cassette. It never was pressed on vinyl that I know of, anyway. I don't think it's about 10 songs or so, and all of them are original. Kenny Bentley, I mean, he was a good songwriter and singer and guitar player. And he wrote some songs, and I wrote several songs. And I guess it's done in Japan. I mean, we sold out whatever we pressed. I don't remember how many it was, but I mean, whatever we, you know, made on cassettes, but that was pretty good. You know, I enjoyed it.
What did you do with the rest of your time while you was there? Just look around?
I walked around, you know, especially the first time we went was in May, and, you know, I just walked around and looked. Now, if you want to go for long distances, you know, they have the public train system, carries you everywhere. It's really big. There's no room for any kind of used stuff or trash or anything, you know, so very few people.
Really?
Kind of more the well-to-do people had cars there in Japan, you know what I'm saying? Everybody else is public transit and stuff. And so I walked a good bit. I mean, we just, and a lot of guys, you know, I had kind of pulled the plug on my partying back in 87.
Right.
So they would go out some of the all-night clubs and come stumbling in. Stumbling in the morning. We didn't have to play till late that evening. You know, you only play for the... But they wouldn't get too bad off that once or twice. But a lot of the people take us out was interesting. It's like we met some people that was kind of like more in the high level management stuff, and some of the Japanese products and stuff you're familiar with here in the States. And they just wanted to be around us. They were real thrilled about Americans in them days. They wanted to dig, you know, pick your brain what America was really like. They'd take us out, and I'd drink a Coca-Cola with them or something, you know, and that was my first brush with karaoke. As me and three of the Japanese guys, they had everybody's arms around each other's shoulders singing Yesterday in karaoke.
Really?
Yeah,
that's pretty fun.
I might should have stuck the rhythm guitar on that one. I don't know, but it was fun. We had a good time, and they were really. I have to say that they were really good people.
That's good. That's great.
They treated us extremely well both trips.
So what happens then after this?
I come back. I moved back from the beach. I think I left in about 94. I think it was with Kid Cole. And I come home, and people start calling me, you know, play. So, you know, I tell them I've been gone, I don't even know what's on the charts, you know, but it's all, you can wing it. So I kind of winged it around with some different bands, you know, around, you know, the Greenville area and stuff like this. Kind of went. And then we formed a band. These people came to see us. Well, actually, we formed a band called Pale Horse. And they still have the band together. One of the bass players we hired on later, not the original bass player, he still keeps the band together.
Huh.
And we, so 1995, we took a house job. And we played there for 2 years. And the club bar wanted to sell it. And so we were playing one night. I said, well, how much do you want? And he made a proposal. And I don't think you know if he thought I was serious or not. I said, well, we'll get together Monday with, you know, attorneys and all this stuff, and we'll. He said, you kidding? I said, no, I'm not kidding. This stuff. So I stayed there 13 years.
Wow.
And, but we had good house bands. Now, they had a great house band out the road from us at the Blind Horse. They had a great, you know, my friend Ronald Radford playing guitar, I told you about, and, you know, and of course, Scotty Hawkins played there for a while too, you know, and stuff. And, but we had a place called The Manor. It was in the Morgan Manor. That was the name I played. It was kind of a famous club. It had been real successful for a lot of people. And so we stayed there, and it kind of like, that side of town started kind of moving. Everything started shifting back downtown, and they were doing a lot of different entertainment downtown for free and stuff, and regulations and stuff. So it was about done all for me. It, you know, about all it's it was going to do for me.
Right, of course,
and, at that point, so I decided to, you know, just close up.
Right.
And let's see, it's 2010 by that time, and so I take off my dog Tanko, he was my buddy, we go down to Florida and just goof off for a little bit, and on the way home I thought I'd get a break for a while, but on the way home I got a call, and these guys were needing a guitarist, a lead guitarist and a singer to play on Princess Cruise Line, and they had a girl lead singer that was really good, Danielle Taylor. I call her Danny, and she covered a lot of ground. I mean, anywhere from Tennessee Waltz to Lady Gaga.
Right.
That's, you know, that's what we had to play. We
were doing. Yeah, I mean, that's a wide array of music. Yeah.
Oh yeah, we played. We'd be out there playing by the swimming pool for the crowd, you know, on the Salos and stuff, doing, you know, the make you feel good songs, and then we may have to do a captain's ball later on with a tuxedo playing kind of jazz oriented and stuff. And then at night we were playing, they'd have theme nights. Like one night we'd have to play country music. We might be playing Saturday Night Fever music, the next night or something. And then we'd do a show. We did some shows too. We'd have to put together some shows and, it really was not quite like people think it, but we just, out there, you know, partying every day, you have to get in the ship system, learn to be part of the system, and you have to be pretty well versed if you're going to do it, because they start cutting back on the budget. By this time, they cut back where one band was doing three bands' jobs.
And
so you had to be a versatile musician to cover that ground, and that's what they're looking for. Those other people, if you can't do it, somebody can.
Oh, yeah, somebody's waiting for that job, I'm sure.
Yes, sir. And we were lucky through the years with Slewfoot and going. I'm actually headed backwards a little bit, but when I tell you playing Chicken Shack in that area, we leaving right after that. We had some bands when we first started playing Greenville stuff. We opened for a lot of bands. I had some pop festivals like things around.
We
opened for a lot of big people, you know.
Yeah.
Cactus and Goose Creek Symphony. And Marshall Tucker was on the bill on one of the jobs we played at. And I mean, I met some of the guys and became friends with some of the guys and stayed in touch. And then with Slewfoot, we got to do a lot of, especially like in 86, we had three records chart that year. And one of them was on the Billboard charts, was It's So Nice to Be With You, the old Gallery song.
Mm-hmm.
And we did a lot of opening for a lot of good people, and like I know you've done so much yourself, but you get some surprises. You get some of the guys you thought was going to be nice, not quite as nice. Yeah. And then the guys that you didn't think was going to be mean to, but they were on such a high level, you didn't expect them to be as nice. And we up for George Strait, man. It's a superstar. And he's one of the nicest guys. He is the real deal, you know.
I like to hear deals like that too. He makes you feel good.
He's a gentleman. He is. And then we left off there at let's see, where was that? We left off at 2010 a moment ago, and then
we was on the cruise ship.
Yeah, and so I come back and Dad's health wasn't going good, so Mama didn't want me to. She didn't want me to go back out, so I didn't. You know, I just started playing. You know, playing around town and picked back up with Pay a Horse.
Yeah,
picked back up with Pay a Horse, and we were popular. We were drawing good. You know, we had to follow him still from Club Four and did real good. Stayed in a while, and then I left. You know, about 5 years ago, and the band I call home right now is a group called the Hot Notes. And it's just a three-piece band.
Right.
Me and I call them John Boys, and Jonathan Bowling, John Boy Bowling, and Tony Crisper. Scotty Hawkins was working with us a good bit. You know, Scotty passed on. You know, and Scotty was working with us a good bit, and then Tony came in after Scotty, But we have variations of that. We take that band and, you know, who hires us, we have horns sometimes.
Different
extra guitar players, extra singers and stuff. But you better be able with there's not that many stages in the local clubs. You're on the floor and the corners and stuff. In three pieces, you better be able to play rhythm and lead guitar.
True. You know what I'm saying?
Now you got to play rhythm and lead to try to get by. And it's not like playing it by the record. It's getting by, you know, and doing vocals. I always think Johnson's a real good singer. If you got good vocals,
you can get by with a lot.
Yeah.
Good vocals, good harmony singers, you can get by with a lot.
Yeah, that's why we started off kind of driving wheel. Dale Hooper, he was a real good singer and real good looking and all that stuff. So we kind of got by. You know, we talked earlier, it helps you and stuff. So we kind of got by. We could cover. Pretty much was on the charts, and we're smart enough not to jump on anything that's above our level playing.
Well, I mean, that's just professional there.
Well, we had to. I mean, it was something we just wasn't ready for. Yeah. That was their first job, first road job, and I had to tell them. I said, "Well, we're not ready for that. We can move to the next song," you know. So, I've been lucky, and even now, you know, I got my buddies. We get to do jobs like I know you had Shane Pruitt on the other day. Shane and I get to play every now and then. I think we've done about three little gigs together this year. Ronald, my buddy Ronald Radford, we haven't done much together lately, but me and him and Scotty's brother played together on and off there for a few years, and boy, that's rewarding to have him and Scotty on the same job, and
that's... Music's been pretty good to you. I mean, you it's a pretty good life you've had.
Yeah, it's been good. I did my first solo album in 2015.
Yeah.
I wrote all the songs on that, and there's some real good musicians on there, and they did a wonderful job on that. And then the last one was back 2018. We did one, Rock House, with, you know Kevin McKendry from Delbert, and he plays with Brian Setzer, and everybody on there was Grammy winners but me.
Well, that's the kind of people you want backing you up.
They were good. Scotty played with me on both of them albums, and all the people in Nashville, you know, he's just so wonderful. All the people he played with, Reba and Kix Brooks, and
that's good.
Played with Jack Pearson. He played with Johnny Neal. Both of them played with the Allman Brothers. You know, Scotty played with that bunch.
That's some fine guitar players there.
Oh boy, he's one of those guys. Everybody say you got to have this kind of guitar and that kind, and he's one that could go pick a Fender Squire unset up off the rack and go play with it and make everybody else wonder what they're doing, you know.
I mean, those guys are a different breed.
They are. They really are. And that's just, you know, you never want to be negative around somebody, but I had some young people ask me and that's a good thing to say in an interview, to ask you how to do it. And I've seen some people look at me like, got four heads sometimes. But they ask you, but it's not quite the answer they want to hear. How do you get these jobs? How did you right. get to play on a record in Nashville? How did you get to play your own part with A-Team?
Right.
How did you play behind a major artist, not just open for them? How have you played, got to play on shows with major artists and stuff? Or they pick you, fill a job on Cruise Line, just whatever. You got to put the work in.
Yeah, exactly.
On stage and off stage. And they want somebody that's dependable, and everybody makes jokes about, you know, their habits, but
right.
You can decide, you can decide what you want to be. You know, I mean, yeah. you know, your habits, they'll make you think you're good, you know, but they could hurt you, you know. I'm saying anything.
Sure they can.
You know that.
To so many people.
You've seen it happen.
I've seen it happen with so many people. You know, there's a lot of stuff involved in some success, but most of it's just hard work.
I just tell people keep between the ditches with, you know, their habits. Try to keep, as Daddy used to tell me, keep it between the ditches, and that means don't get there too far or too left or too far right. And
right.
Keep yourself in check and try to surround yourself with people. If you would have, you know, you've done it. You can play with a band that's got some vision and it really cares about what they're doing, or you can play in drunk bands.
True, you can.
You know what? I'm
not playing both.
Yeah, I have to. I probably have people mad at me a few times, but you know, that's as you go on, you know,
you do learn. If you're going to survive, you know, you have to, you know.
Well, yeah, and that's what keeps you in the system.
And that's a good advice for young musicians, you know. And yeah, we're a couple old guys talking about it, but we're a couple old guys who have made music for a long time, and there's a reason, you know.
Yeah, you see it coming. Nowadays, you've played long enough that you actually, even if it's a song, you can't quite get there with your abilities. You see, you hear it, and you recognize it, you know, and you know not play every song, every note that you know on every song, you know.
I know songs to stay away from myself personally.
Oh yeah, you know, I talked on the phone, you know, a few days back. Yeah. We talked about some, well, I guess it's hard to choose favorites, you know. And I have bands I love and individual musicians, but one of my favorite guitar players is Jeff Beck.
Yeah.
I'm going to practice. If I practice every day, I'm not going to play like Jeff Beck. It doesn't matter. You know what I mean? I don't mean negative. He's on another universe. And then, but another one of my favorite guitar players, Reggie Young.
Yeah, Reggie.
And, you know, I don't play like Reggie Young, but
that's tasty stuff, though.
I got a chance on becoming a better tasty guitar player by trying to emulate some of this stuff. I mean, I got a good chance on, I like that. I kind of like that kind of guitar player.
Well,
those
guys went a long ways with playing tasty chops. Reggie's one of them.
Yeah, if you just think of the intro on Drift Away, nobody plays it right, and he's the only one ever plays it right, and it's great, you know. And
yeah.
I mean, you couldn't improve on that song.
No, you
couldn't. I've heard remakes of it, and they got close on the intro, but it wasn't, you know, wasn't authentic. But Reggie's just a great, you know. You think about his solos and stuff, and his little intro licks, and that's him on the Billy Swan on I Can Help.
Which is a great tune, too, before I forget it.
That is a great tune. Him and the producer were angry at each other about that one. They actually got, so he's like, take this, and he puts this little lick in there. That's what the story is. He's great. So, I never try to be a hotshot guitar player. I try, and then if, but it gets me jobs now. I mean, like, and I like playing with different people. I mean, I like going in there unrehearsed and,
well, you've done, you've...
trying to, you know, just, you know, try to do a good
again,
job.
You spent a long time doing that. I mean, you've...
Yeah.
I mean, your catalog must be massive.
Well, you just don't know what's going to happen when it comes out. Sometimes things come back to me. You know, I might do a, like I told you, when you and I were talking off the air, I might do a hymn at the end of the night, you know, because I grew up, Daddy took me to church every Sunday and every Wednesday, too, so I might throw one of the old Southern Baptist hymns in there, you know, if somebody wants to hear it, and then with the hot notes every now and then, we'll break out and do some Sinatra, and then
there's nothing wrong with that.
I broke into down in Spartanburg the other night at a club playing with another band. I broke into some Pink Floyd and Led Zeppelin. You know, I mean, it just and it actually went over. But you know, it's just I just like music.
Yeah, I like music too, and yeah. I think that's a big part of it too. Neil, I know it's a long ride up here, buddy, but I do appreciate you coming and doing this.
Yes, sir.
This has been something I've been looking forward to for a long time.
Well, I'm just humbled that, you know, you're so nice and the things you said to me and,
Yeah.
I mean,
I've been looking forward to this one and
thank you.
Hadn't let me down. It's a good story, man.
Thank you. I sure appreciate you and Sandy, I really do. And coming from you, you're one of the veterans too, so I appreciate that. And,
well. I appreciate you coming. This has been really good. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Touch me that way.